Talk later.
Bye.
Good morning, church.
Good morning.
And welcome, one and all, and a special welcome to Lynn's friend and extraordinary musician, Scott Will Weaver, who we will get to hear a number of times this morning, and we are so grateful anytime that Scott is able to be with us and share his prodigious musical talents. So welcome, welcome, Scott, and welcome one and all to anyone joining us from the Zoom sanctuaries of their homes or wherever they might be. Welcome to all of you gathered here in the sanctuary at East Congregational Church on this morning of Christmas Eve Day, where we will gather again at 7 p.m. for our candlelight Christmas Eve worship as well. So that's one of the announcements, is that is at 7 p.m. We will do that hybrid as well on Zoom. Live stream, and also here in the sanctuary of the building. Thank you to everyone who has brought generous gifts to share with the clients of Interfaith Social Services, diapers, children's books, a variety of things here that we are just delighted to be able to pass on. So thank you for your generosity, and if you bring some this evening, we'll still keep passing those on. We will get them to the people
who need them. So thank you so very, very much. Also, just a reminder that next Sunday, December 31st, which will be New Year's Eve day, Lynn and Beth and I will all be away, and so we have received and accepted the invitation of First Congregational Church of Milton to join them for a potluck brunch and worship in Johnson Hall. The potluck is, if you can, if you can't and still want to come, there'll be plenty of food. So, but that'll be at 10 a.m. in Johnson Hall at First Congregational Church. So please know that that invitation has been given to us as well. And I think that those announcements kind of situate us so we can move right now into from getting here to being here. And I would ask Linda and those members of our healing prayer group who are going to lead us in our call to worship and the lighting of our Advent candles to come forward.
I can go to town out there.
Thank you.
Good morning. Please join me in the call to worship with the lighting of our Advent candles. What if the dark is not an end, but a door? What if the dark is the way a new beginning comes? As great cold waves heave and crash, lake trout glides beneath at ease. She's returned from a very long journey. In late fall, she felt a sudden urge. Go home. She swam miles and miles to a certain pile of rocks stacked on the lake's bottom.
A swirling communion, a lake trout reunion met her there. They swam, silver sides pressed together until eggs fell from her body into cracks among the rocks, hidden from hungry fish and churning currents.
She once was an egg there, waiting to hatch. Trusting her home place to shelter her own eggs, she swam away. Now they waited. If everyone could.
It's a door. It's the way a new beginning comes.
Today we light the new candle for love as together we sing.
And for those who do not know, our healing prayer group with COVID went vitally virtual and has stayed that way, but is an incredibly engaged group of a number of people who pray monthly, daily, as needed together for healing and wholeness for those we love and know and so many situations across our world in need. And one of the members of that healing prayer group was also Marian Nelson, whom passed from this life into the next early this week. And so I know that there is much healing prayer surrounding her sons, Steve and Philip and their families in this time of mourning. So thank you, healing prayer, for leading us in that lighting of our Advent wreath. Please join your spirits with mine now in prayer. Gracious God, we give you thanks for this season of Advent, a season that we mark in many different ways in our lives and in the life of our congregation. And this year, we have done so moving through this season with the stories of some of the animals of your creation. And we give you thanks that all creation waits for the gifts of this season as well as the seasons to come. And we each take our own way to prepare. So let us continue to prepare for the arrival of the light of the world, which we will gather together this night to celebrate as well. As we gather, continue to prepare, wait in so many different ways, we give you thanks that you travel and are present with us. In Christ's name we pray, amen. I invite us now to rise in body or spirit as we are able, turning to number 121 in the black hymnals, and sing together, All Earth is Waiting. Audrey, would you be willing to meet me up here on the steps? You didn't sleep. Oh, well, then you're tired, right? Oh, gosh. So you didn't sleep at all last night. You're not sleeping at all tonight. Well, you're going to be tired kids. All right. Okay. So does this book look familiar to you? Yeah? I'm hoping it does. This is actually the book from which it's called All Creation Waits, The Advent Mystery of New Beginnings. And it is where we have taken words, different features, from, because there's one for each day of December, and we have used them to help us focus ourselves on the darkness, but also the increasing light that comes in this season as we've lit the candles on our Advent wreath. So I'm curious, and maybe you don't have a favorite in here yet, but do you have a favorite? Do you have a favorite animal that you've discovered in here and read about? Okay, all right, well, I have some favorites, but I want to share one more today about the Eastern fox squirrel, because I don't know about you, but it never takes long to find a squirrel if you just look around outside, right? They're everywhere, absolutely everywhere. So listen to this one about the Eastern fox squirrel. This was for Advent 21, which was also the winter solstice. It says, a furry flag flicks in the snow, topples and pops up fox squirrel, mouthful. When acorns, hickory, and walnuts fell from the trees in fall, he gobbled his belly full, then hid thousands more. Nut-loving neighbors watched. So he played nut-hiding tricks. Dig a hole, pretend to drop an acorn in. Do this again. Dig hole number 3. Bury the acorn there. Maybe. Come back later. Bury it somewhere new. Or pretend to. For months, Squirrel remembered which hole really hid his buried treasure. Do you think you could do that? I know, it sounds hard, doesn't it? Because Fox Squirrel doesn't want to spend winter sleeping. Eating nuts hidden and found, he can keep tree leaping. Now, the other thing that I love about this book is in the back, there are more what they call animal wonderings in the very back. And listen to this about the Eastern Fox Squirrel. Fox Squirrel eats 2 pounds of nuts every week. Have you ever weighed 2 pounds of nuts? You might want to try that. It's a lot. He remembers not only where he hides his nuts, but also which kind of nut is in each hole. Next time you look out at a squirrel, you go, how do you think they remember that? I don't know. That sounds really tough for me. He hides red oak tree acorns in the most secret places and saves them for the coldest weather because they give him more energy. How does your family get ready for difficult weather? Do you do anything special if you know the weather's going to be extra bad? Umbrellas, that's right. It's good to have an umbrella. What about footwear? You wear different footwear in certain kinds of weather. Boots, yeah, right. What about food? Do you get different food if you think... No, hot chocolate. You and me. That's right. Nice. Hot chocolate and cookies. What? Hanging out on the couch if it's snowing really cold outside. Well, one of the things I love about this book is it helps us learn things about animals, but also about, I know squirrels are running around all the time burying things, but I had no idea that they could remember where they put exactly a certain kind of nut. That's pretty phenomenal. So remembering and waiting go hand in hand, and so does loving creation, because all creation waits for the light that is God. So today, instead of singing you off to Sunday school, we're going to ask you to stay for one more piece of music, especially because we've got Scott and a really special piece of music, just so that you can kind of hear that. So why don't you sit in the front pew there with Miss Beth? And we'll get this special music from our soloists and Scott. And Lynn's going to talk about the flip of the piece of music in the program, too.
Good morning, everyone. Am I on?
Slight change in the program, actually. We're going to do Omanu Mysterium first. And I just wanted to tell you a tiny bit about this. But first, I would like to welcome Sarah, who's been with us before and hopefully will join us again. Caitlin and Sarah will be singing this piece along with Scott and I playing. Ivo Antonini is the composer of this piece, and he writes that he wrote this as a brief but powerful piece that I wrote for a small church choir directed by my wife, Patricia, for Christmas of 2010. It was meant as a gift for those good people that came once a week to prepare for the service. So this version uses two treble voices and cello. There is an SATB unaccompanied version also.
Our scripture reading this morning is from the Gospel of Luke.
Luke chapter 1, verses 46 to 55. And Mary said, "My soul magnifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Savior, for God has looked with favor on the lowly state of this servant. Surely from now on all generations will call me blessed, for the Mighty One has done great things for me, and holy is God's name. Indeed, God's mercy is for those who revere God from generation to generation. God has shown strength with God's arm and scattered the proud in the imagination of their hearts.
The Lord has brought down the powerful from their thrones and lifted up the lowly. The Lord has filled the hungry with good things and sent the rich away empty. God has come to the aid of God's own people, Israel, in remembrance of God's mercy, according to the promise God made to our ancestors, to Abraham and Sarah, and to their descendants forever. God's word for God's people. Thanks be to God.
Because our season of Advent has been centered with words a bit more unusual, coming from all creation waits, I wanted to give us all a chance to hear a little bit more about its context and why it was actually just almost one of those gifts that showed up kind of around Thanksgiving. This is the first year that Paraclete Press, which is in Brewster, Massachusetts, did a children's edition of this book. There's been an adult edition out for some time, but they got an illustrator to work with the author and create these just what is just really a gorgeous, gorgeous children's book. And of course, as many of you know, because you've had the opportunity to use our amazing church library, thank you, Holly Meyer, and librarians who came before, including Emma Schroeder. We've got some just beautiful children's books in there that are oftentimes as much for us as adults as they are for children. And so Beth and I talked about the possibility of gifting this book to each of the families in our congregation who have young children and that are connected to our Christian education and faith formation program. So we felt like that was a wonderful opportunity to do that. So we did make sure that each family got a copy of this about the second week of Advent because the publisher had some shipping issues, but that happens, right? And of course, there are 24 days in Advent. So there was a note that came with that to help our families center in the season of Advent as well. But a couple of pieces that I wanted to share with you, one of which is just a lovely, lovely Meister Eckhart quote, which I did not know. Of course, the one of Meister Eckhart that I share regularly is the one that if we only said one prayer in our life and it were thank you, that would be enough. But this great mystic also has this quote attributed to him. Every single creature is full of God and is a book about God. Every single creature is full of God and is a book about God. Life looks differently through that lens. It looks different. It opens us to a different kind of wonder. Wonder about that Eastern gray squirrel who can hide nuts and pretend to hide them in certain places, but really I'm going to hide it over here, and I'm going to remember where I put that one. Goodness gracious. But this book opens with this lovely positioning for us, because it is in our northern hemisphere. But it says, in late fall in the world's north, the sun glides low in the sky. Light dims, the air cools, signaling every living thing. Animals know what to do when the season of dark and cold spreads over the earth. Every creature makes changes to its home, its body, its habits. Every creature makes ready to wait until the earth wakes again into the light and warmth of spring. Waiting in the cold dark will be hard, but each creature knows the dark is not an end, it's a door. It's the way a new beginning comes. So there were four that I chose out of the book to anchor the lighting of our four Advent candles. The first was Painted Turtle, who stills itself and slows way down. Now, I don't know how many of us choose to enter Advent that way. I think it's on my bucket list. Someday. But it also says the painted turtle knows that if it stays busy and not still, it will die. So it knows it must stay still. And waiting is its one and only work. And it's not easy, but it knows it must. So different ways to wait is also part of the wonder of this journey with these animals. The second, and so the first was hope. The first candle is hope. Painted turtle seemed to really symbolize hope in that essential waiting, as hard as it is. And muskrat was our second candle, the second Sunday. And muskrat's no winter napper. Muskrat's not going to wait around, but swim like a maniac in the freezing cold water. But muskrat does have to rest too. And so muskrat has a little waiting room that sometimes it's in alone, and sometimes it's huddled with others to share the warmth. And I loved that message too, that sometimes in our waiting, we are alone. And that can be okay. More okay for some of us than maybe for others. But other times, there's amazing value in waiting and huddling together to gather warmth and solidarity and companionship from one another. And muskrat also knows that when it dives to the bottom of the pond, there are fresh greens waiting for it all year long, even in the dark and cold. The second candle we light in Advent is the candle for peace. Then the third Sunday, we light the candle for joy. And it seemed to me that 20,000 honeybee sisters humming all together, shivering all together, actually in the cold, were an interesting symbol for joy, because they cluster together in the hollow of an old oak tree, keeping one another and the queen in their center warm. Because without that, they can't go on. They need that warmth. And each bee knows that to live through the winter, they all must dance and shiver together. Wouldn't that be something if we could learn that? In order to make it through the winter and the dark times, we need to dance together and huddle together to keep each other warm. And then this morning, of course, so the third candle, joy. And this morning, our healing prayer led us with the fourth candle lighting for love. So the story of the lake trout, who has this instinct when it's time for her to go home to lay her own eggs, she goes exactly where it was that she began her own life cycle as an egg. That full circle of living and loving that she goes through. And once she lays her own eggs in the bottom of a lake, she swims away, knowing the egg will wait until it's time for a new lake trout to be born. Love comes full circle and brings us home. This book also, because the refrain at the end of each offering is, the dark is not an end, it's a door. It's the way a new beginning comes, really resonated with me for us in this Advent season as a congregation. Because of our process through faithful future planning and through the working groups on our scenarios, brought us just before Advent to a momentous congregational vote to make a dramatic change in our life as a congregation and set out on the path toward consolidation. There is a certain waiting and darkness and wondering, is this an end? Or in what ways might it be a door and a new beginning, so that light might shine anew in, with, and through us in our relationship and our discipleship with Christ? I do believe for us as a congregation This is one way a new beginning can come and is coming. So we give thanks for that as well. And then tonight, on Christmas Eve, we will light the Christ candle in the center of the Advent wreath with the final piece from this book, which, well, I can't tell you, you got to come, right? But it does help us remember that all creation waits. All creation waits for the coming of the light in our hearts, in our lives, and in our world. And as we continue to wait, even this morning of the fourth Sunday of Advent, with eager longing, we await the return of the light in our northern hemisphere and to our Christ candle in the center of the unending Advent wreath that we light and share each year. Thanks be to God for the gifts of hope and peace and joy and love and light. Amen and amen. I invite us now to rise in body or spirit again as we are able, so that together we might join our voices and sing number 148 in our black hymnals, What Child Is This? Church, so that we might continue to build and serve community in Christ's name, whether those gifts come to the offering boxes in the front or back of the church, through our online giving portal, or in any way they can get here, but especially also for your time and talent. In addition to your treasure, we give great thanks. So now we will receive the gift of our morning offertory. I invite us now into a time of prayer together, which we will begin in silence with a sharing of our joys and sorrows and uncertainties, both through the Zoom chat as well as the green prayer cards in the pew racks before you. After that time of silence, I will collect the ones in the building and weave them together with the ones on Zoom so that we might weave them together in our hearts before God. We will follow that with a responsive acclamation of the goodness of our God, some words of pastoral prayer, and then a sharing of the words of our Lord's Prayer together. So let us now begin this time of prayer in silence as we gather our joys, sorrows, and uncertainties. Even as these prayers are but the beginning of all our prayers, we give thanks that they are shared among us and between us so that we might weave them together into the depths of our hearts, even as we place them before God. And knowing there are many more, spoken and unspoken, we still, as an act of faith, choose to acclaim that God is good. All the time, God is good. Let us continue to pray. Good and gracious and holy God, we give you thanks for the people and the places and the needs we have placed before you and one another in prayer this day. Thank you for connecting us in this way to the joys and the sorrows and the uncertainties of our lives, even our lives in you. And we give thanks that these prayers are one way that we can weave together our lives and our faith and our love and our longing. And as we do, O God, we give thanks that those first disciples who gathered around Jesus had the good sense to ask him how to pray, so that the story comes to us and the words of this prayer have come to us through the centuries, that we now lift our voices together and pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. I invite you now to turn again in your black hymnals to number 139. Rise in body or spirit as you are able, so that we may together sing the first Noel.
Oh,
before the blessing of this morning. A reminder that if you donated poinsettias that you wish to take home with you this morning, please come up and get one. We also have some that are in need of delivery. So if you are able to deliver a poinsettia, maybe to someone who lives close by, please come up to the communion table there in the corner, and we've got the addresses and names of those for whom we will deliver poinsettias. They are beautiful and stunning this season, so thank you for all who have gifted us with the beauty of these flowers. So go now on this Christmas Eve day, knowing that light still shines in the darkness. The darkness cannot and will not ever overcome it. And that light is for you to take with you in your heart and in your life, so that it may shine the way before you, and you might also help shine the way for others. Go in that light, and with the love of God, the peace of Christ, and the power of the Holy Spirit, now and always. Amen.